Start. Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. On behalf of China Bhavan Vishwabharati, I have the honor to warmly welcome you all to this inaugural session of the two-day webinar on understanding China from a multidisciplinary perspective. China Bhavan has a glorious tradition of being the proud host of numerous conferences of great academic significance. It is our honor to have amongst us His Excellency Ambassador Vikram Misri as a chief guest for this occasion, who is also the Indian ambassador to China. Respected Professor Komal Shil, retired professor of Chinese studies, Benaras Hindu University, an eminent scholar in Chinese studies in India, and Professor Abhijit Banerjee, head of the department, China Bhavan, Vishwabharati, will present their speeches in this inaugural session. Now I invite our dear students to perform the Vedic song as per the welcoming tradition of Vishwabharati. With due respect, I request you all to please stand up for this singing ceremony. Now I request Professor Abhijit Banerjee, head of the department, China Bhavan Vishwabharati, to present his introductory speech.
Respected Indian Ambassador to China, His Excellency Mr. Vikram Misri, Professor Komal Shil, distinguished retired professor, Benaras Hindu University, distinguished chairs of various academic sessions of this webinar, speakers presenting papers in this webinar, distinguished scholars from various parts of the country, academicians of Vishwabharati, students of Vishwabharati and from various parts of country, staffs of Vishwabharati, ladies and gentlemen, it gives me tremendous contentment to be presenting the welcome speech amongst the most esteemed personalities who have won accolades in their respective fields. It gives me great pleasure to extend to you all a very warm welcome on behalf of Chinnabhavan Vishwabharati to this two-day webinar on understanding China from a multidisciplinary perspective. Rabindranath Tagore, founder of this institution, believed in mutually beneficial interactive relationship between the two great civilizations of India and China. He advocated the reopening of the path between the two countries. Since Tagore established Chinnabhavan in 1937, the department has played a pioneering role in promoting the educational and cultural exchange between the two ancient civilizations. In recent years, Chinnabhavan has been organizing many events, including international conferences, language competition, mutual visits between the faculties and students of Vishwabharati and the Chinese universities, cultural program that has helped in promoting India-China people-to-people exchange. The webinar schedule brushes upon a spectrum of exciting and benefiting themes that discuss the various aspects of China studies in India. Before we begin this seminar, I would like to express my sincere thanks to all of you who committed to this event to make it a success. This event would have been impossible without the support of each and everyone present here. I want to convey my heartfelt gratitude to His Excellency Mr. Vikram Misri, Indian Ambassador to China, for accepting the invitation in spite of his busy schedule. I am also grateful to Professor Kamal Shil, keynote speaker, for accepting the invitation, and all the distinguished scholars who have given their consent to chair the various sessions of this webinar. On behalf of Chinnabhavan Vishwabharati, I am obliged to all the paper presenters from various parts of the country who have made it to the webinar. These papers should enlighten all of us on the importance of studying China in the present scenario. I am sure that the webinar will be profitable and fruitful for everyone present here. Thank you.
It's our great honor to have amongst us His Excellency Ambassador Vikram Misri, Indian Ambassador to China, as the chief guest for this occasion. His Excellency Ambassador Vikram Misri served in various capacities at the headquarters of the Ministry of External Affairs, Government of India, in the Prime Minister's Office, New Delhi, and in various Indian missions abroad in Europe, Africa, Asia, and North America, and as Ambassador of India to Spain, Myanmar, and now as Ambassador of India to China. With due respect, sir, I request you to please present your speech.
Thank you. Thank you also to Professor Banerjee. Good morning to you and to all the other distinguished experts gathered for this very important webinar. It's a pleasure for me to have this opportunity to say a few words as you get underway. The first thoughts that I have in my mind as I join you today are related to my first and unfortunately so far only visit to Vishwabharati, which was more than 23 years ago. The year, if I recall correctly, was 1997. I was working in those days for Prime Minister I.K. Gujral, who was paying an official visit to Shanti Niketan. The tour of Chinnabhavan during that visit is still etched in my mind, not least because of another interesting connection that goes back even further. 16 years prior to that visit to Shanti Niketan, when I had entered Delhi University in 1981, the first lectures in Chinese history that I got were from Professor Tan Chom, the illustrious son of the equally illustrious Professor Tan Yun Shan, a figure with whom all of you are all too familiar and whose name is somewhat inseparable from the history of Chinnabhavan itself. Professor Tan Chom was, of course, teaching in JNU in those days, but had very kindly agreed to come to my alma mater, Hindu College in the University of Delhi, to deliver the first dozen or so lectures of a brand new course on the history of China and Japan for the undergraduate program in history in Delhi University. all of you might be interested to learn that I was delighted to be reunited with him, with Professor Tan Chung, last year, right here in Beijing, after a gap of nearly four decades. your discussions over the next 2 days on a broad swathe of subjects and themes that cover all areas of relevance to the India-China relationship come at a particularly sensitive juncture in the long history of this important relationship. And since you have assembled, as I can see, a most impressive list of speakers to address these issues, I will limit my remarks only to some of the immediate priorities as they appear to me. When I came to China nearly 2 years ago as ambassador, I must admit that I was already convinced of the progress this country had made in overcoming poverty, its gains in human development, its position as a manufacturing superpower, and its efforts to make a mark for itself as an S&T force and a digital innovator to reckon with. Many of these were also areas where India had complementary interests and where I thought that we could work together and exchange knowledge and experiences even as we addressed the difficult questions in our relationship. The common civilizational heritage of both countries, about which both Professor Tan Yun Shan and Professor Tan Chung have written so eloquently, was a unique and valuable platform on which to premise future cooperation. This approach was also built on the promising efforts over the past three decades of the relationship and grounded in the consensus that while the settlement of the boundary question would not be an impediment in the positive development of other aspects of the relationship, such as the people-to-people contacts that Professor Banerjee referred to, the prevalence of peace and tranquility on the border was a necessary condition for the relationship to develop further. Over these three decades, two parallel impulses therefore progressed side by side. The relationship expanded significantly into areas that were simply not there three decades ago, the bilateral trade and investment being the most significant example. And the two sides also built in parallel multiple institutional arrangements to preserve peace and tranquility on the border. However, earlier this year, as you would all be aware, this consensus came under obvious strain as a result of the somewhat unprecedented actions taken by the Chinese PLA since April this year. The resurfacing of these border tensions over the last 6 months on a scale and with a scope and extent not seen in more than three decades has led to fundamental questions being raised once again about the founding premises of this relationship and about the institutional mechanisms that underpinned its management. Everything that we know about the buildup to those events, their actual unfolding, and their continuing nature, even through a process of negotiations, strengthens the belief that this is not about some routine transgressions which have happened several times in the past and have been addressed through existing mechanisms. Righting this ship will now take considerable time and renewed effort, and that too in an international context marked by dynamics that add to the complexities of the relationship and complicate the resolution of the issues that have arisen now. Since these events are somewhat unprecedented, at least in my generation, their emergence has had inevitable consequences for the relationship at large. Now, even as both sides remain engaged in dialogue at military and diplomatic levels to completely disengage their forces and de-escalate the situation, I'm afraid that it will be some time before we see a return to business as usual. Indeed, I would say that in a fundamental sense, the underlying narrative of India-China relations has changed, and it will be important for all of us to imbibe the new reality and find a new vocabulary to articulate it. China has not been explicit in explaining the logic, if any, behind its recent actions. As longtime China watchers, I'm sure that many of you will have views on this. For my part, I will not speculate on the motivations of China in this forum, as my more immediate priority is to handle the fallout and move past the immediate crisis if we can. The fact that we have managed to maintain steady channels of communication at multiple levels through this crisis, which is certainly not over, is a sign of much needed maturity in our engagement. At some point, though, there will need to be a fuller reckoning with China's moves, and we will need to make our own determinations about the way forward. We will also have to be mindful of the fact that there are long-term changes afoot in multiple global theaters, even as we address our immediate issues. These evolving global dynamics will also need to be taken into account as we move forward, because many of the old certainties that we took for granted on the international front are no longer so. The challenge for us is whether we will be able to find new ways of cooperating as well as competing as global institutions evolve and new architectures on trade and security come into place. In short, how do we find our place in the new and evolving balance of power on the global level and in a global environment that is no longer as benign as it was a decade ago and has been changed, perhaps forever in some ways, by the COVID pandemic? Amidst all this, we will still be faced with the enormous challenge of building a modus vivendi with our largest neighbor, China. I'm confident that we can do this, but it will take much greater frankness and readiness to grasp the nettle and deal with the difficult issues in the relationship that bedeviled it nearly three generations ago and continue to bedevil it today. Kicking this can further down the road on these issues is a sure recipe for persistence of distrust and instability in the relationship. However, even in these grim times, when opinion on China has taken an understandably hard turn in India, I recall what one of the architects of China Bhavan, Professor Than Yun Shan, said in a lecture in 1934 at Shantiniketan, namely that Indians and Chinese must wake up and restore our relationship, create a new world civilization, and relieve all mankind. These are words spoken in a different age, no doubt, and with much having flown down the river of history in the time since they were spoken in the precincts of Shantiniketan. But they also hold out the indication that the two countries possess the genius to find their way out of this conundrum, adopt a constructive and positive way forward, and ensure that bright future for their peoples that their thinkers and leaders, past and present, have long articulated. Thank you for this opportunity to share these thoughts. I wish you all the best in your deliberations over the coming 2 days. Thank you again.
Thank you, sir, for your very illuminating speech. It's our honor to have amongst us respected Professor Komal Shil, who is a retired professor in Chinese studies from the Department of Foreign Languages, Banaras Hindu University. He also served as a dean of the Faculty of Arts, Banaras Hindu University, and as rector in Banaras Hindu University. He is also a member and vice president of the executive board at the International Confucian Association and an adjunct fellow at the Institute of Chinese Studies, New Delhi. His research interests are social and intellectual history of China and the cultural interaction and encounters in Asia with a focus on India and China. With due respect, sir, I request you to please present your speech.
Thank you, Atreya. And, am I audible?
Yes, sir.
His Excellency, Honorable Ambassador of India to China, Mr. Bikram Mishri, Professor Abhijit Banerjee, distinguished scholars, participants, and the students, it's really a great honor to be here in this very, you know, important conference. And I must say, it's very difficult to resist Abhijit Banerjee's ability to persuade to join if every time when there is a conference in Shantiniketan. But I really like, you know, Shantiniketan and the good work that they are doing, you know, in the field of Chinese studies. I must say that we are passing through a phase of complexities, anxieties, and conflicts in India-China relations that has to a great extent overwhelmed the civilizational bonhomie among them. To be sure, India-China relations in the modern period has been configured and has evolved through various forms of the age-long civilizational connectedness and modern national concerns. Experts in international relations have seen Chinese foreign policy overriding its belief in five principles of peaceful coexistence to wolf warrior diplomacy. On the ground level in India, this has been reflected in shifting discourses or continuing tensions between Sinophilia and Sinophobia. In such a context, it is necessary to place our attention to understanding China. This conference, by taking up this subject, is making a relevant, worthwhile effort to interrogate China. My paper entitled Understanding China, Some Observations on Shifts in Chinese Nationalism, concerns some of my loud thinking on this issue. The question is how to interrogate China. There are many elements in Chinese history that may be picked up for this purpose. In making of modern China, one cannot, however, deny the critical role of nationalism or nationalisms. How did nationalisms encounter with China's long history and its vast civilizational repertoire shape many essentials that facilitate our comprehension of modern China? Scholars have variously interpreted how anti-feudal and anti-imperialist nationalism of the May 4th overwhelmed other ideologies of nationalism in modern China and configured a kind of mass nationalism that successfully galvanized intellectuals and masses to ultimately hold or build a modern nation state. So wide and far-reaching has been its influence that the performance and feelings of the contemporary state are still measured by its mirrored vision and goal. The May 4th undoubtedly reverberates the polity and society of contemporary China, which has therefore been lauded and represented as the dividing line between tradition and modern and a watershed in Chinese nationalism. The May 4th nationalism that proved dominant at that time, as scholars like Maurice Meisner have aptly demonstrated, was entwined with socialism. The Chinese Communist Revolution thus carried a mandate of national liberation and social liberation. Nationalist visions promoted rapid realization of Chinese self-strengtheners, historical task of attaining wealth and power, while socialist beliefs presupposed institution of any conceivable kind of democratic form. This was historically, as scholars have pointed out, an unholy alliance, an incongruous or incompatible marriage that Mao maintained through its various maneuvering activities, policies, and movements. This uneasy alliance began to break up with the death of Mao. Necessities of nationalist goal took priority over envisioned socialism. With capitalism proving to be rapid and better performing in fulfilling nationalist goals of wealth and power, both nationalism and capitalism formed natural alliance and reinforced each other. This in form fortified the socialist state and place and status of its bureaucratic elite. The success of the consequent transformation has proved to be so alluring to all the symbiotically entwined constituent of the contemporary engine of growth that it has now become next to impossible to reverse the tide. Yet, it cannot be denied that such a rapid transformation of China greatly impacted the mainstream ideology of nationalism that was entwined with socialist vision. Simmering crisis and occasional May 4th-like outburst of dissent in People's Republic of China indicate growing tension between the May 4th modernity and state nationalism. It also reveals limitation of the May 4th ideology to tackle dilemma and predicament inherent in and arising out of new transformation with congruent culture and political authority. To be sure, exploration of nationalism during the May 4th contained within it various forms arising from the tension between the pursuit of modernity and the conservation of tradition. Having remained unresolved by the May 4th radical and iconoclastic vision and promises, it continued to exist, intervene, and aggrandize the state's vision and goal, and produced contestation between the strands of enlightenment, Qimeng, and nationalism or national salvation, Jiuguo, or between the civilizational state and the nation state. Within this contestation, the status and nature of enlightenment, civilization, tradition, culture, nationalism, and modernity have been rendered problematic. They, however, provide some sense and meaning to contemporary manifestation of nationalism. This directs our attention to modern China's nationalistic pursuit of historically available modes of networks, identities, and linkages in the quest for building a strong nation state in wake of various contestations. Nationalism supports the political status quo and facilitates maintenance of harmony and stability. This produced exhortation for building society with Chinese characteristics, erecting a harmonious society, pursuit of the Chinese dream, and many other such slogans and guidelines which carry potent ideas that can mean anything, but common to all is a strong desire or assertion to go back to the roots, to seek legitimacy. New Confucianism, new nationalism, and new humanism are the contemporary buzzwords. With the growing strength and confidence, the Chinese state is getting actively engaged in creating an alternative discourse of modernity and nationalism. To be sure, such tensions and contestations in the construction of a dominant ideology for nation building do not suggest an end to the historical project of enlightenment and modernity, but the continuity of appearance and reappearance of aspirations that have roots in tradition. The normativeness of tradition is the inertial force which holds society in a given form over the time. The idea of tradition has figured prominently in recent discourse on nationalism in China. One example of such discourse in China is New Confucianism or New Nationalism. This has been further sharpened by those who bring pre-Qin thinkers and texts to enrich and improve the debate on current nationalism and international politics. These included, besides Confucius and Mencius, thinkers like Lao Tzu, Quan Tzu, Mo Tzu, Sun Tzu, and Han Fei Tzu, and focused on their highlighted texts of that period. Pitted against that are discourses on alternative modernity. While these all stem from sources inherent in Chinese tradition, the former has received the backing of the post-Mao state, and the latter evinces aspiration of new dissidents. Here we particularly focus on New Confucianism, which has now gained center stage, now with the strong patronage of the state because of its powerful legitimization of the state activities and support to new is linked with efforts to renew and restore Confucianism, which was rejected as moribund, static, and dead ideology, to act as viable philosophical and cultural resource against feudal and imperialist forces in the late 19th and early 20th century China. Overwhelmed by the dominant anti-feudal and anti-imperialist May 4th ideology of nationalism and modernity, it had remained dormant in the Maoist state. Yet it continued to be linked with the Kuomintang state in Taiwan and overseas Chinese. With the post-Maoist state gaining strength, New Confucianism increasingly gained status and state patronage in mainland China. The term New Confucianism has been employed in such a way that it has served to exercise a homogenizing effect, obscuring philosophical complexities and differences. As such, it presents a homogenized Confucian discourse for Chinese domestic consumption. This was accompanied by valorization of Confucian modernizers like Cheng Kuo-fan, Li Yongchang, Kang Youwei, Jiang Zhishi, Yang Shuming, and many such others. For New Confucianists, the role model has been Kang Youwei. In the genealogy of ideologues of Chinese nationalism, Kang stands among the first of intellectual modernizers to promote Confucianism-inspired modernity to save and strengthen China. A radical ideology in its own time, it was pushed back after the collapse of the Qing to the category of conservative nationalism by the new radicalism of the May 4th. Yet not only did his idea take into account special characteristics of China in framing the blueprint of its modernity, it also vehemently rejected enlightenment-based nationalism in favor of Confucian universalism-based nationalism. This was what that had put Kang among the most important intellectuals in the schema of New Confucians in contemporary China. Kang developed his ideas in context other than the capitalist West that generated or imagined a set of space, language, belief, and history that was self or ours against, despite, and external others. As such, Kang, as Wang Hui remarks, discussed such questions as China, Han ethnicity, and Chinese culture in terms of hybridity, attempting to use this view of a hybrid China to resist European-style ethnic nationalism and to form a capacious Chinese identity or imperial Chinese identity. Kang's resolution on maintaining border, sovereignty, and people thus overturns visions and goals of the May 4th nationalism, replacing individual and class with the state and people. Chen Ming writes, is the basic characteristics of the new generation's ideological discourse, whose goal is the China dream. This is the return of the central question of the modern era, a return to Confucian ideas and a new understanding of the CCP's original intent in founding the party to save China. To propose returning to Kangyuwei in this context has not only theoretical significance, but poses an equally important practical significance. Particularly appealing for the new Confucians and the state was Kang's steadfast belief in multi-ethnic hybrid empire nation state of China and strong avowed aversion to the idea of nationalism, promoting fragmentation of country by establishing autonomous specific identity-based provinces. He instead articulated an alternative enlightened vision of reform and progress, which was based on hybridity evolved out of native legitimizing ideology. This brought Kang once again prominently in picture in attempt to configure contemporary China. For Kang, Western notion of nation state and nationalism as necessary instrument for progress and modernity was infallible. He finds more differences between China and Europe than similarities. Changing political maps of the nation and state in Europe in the 19th century was uncomforting to his idea of unity, peace, and harmony. China, he emphasizes, belongs to Asia and the Asian race. Its politics and culture are like Asian countries. West-inspired concept of nationalism or a revolution that threatened division of China into independent provinces and sought to build ethnic majority-based nation-state was dangerous. This had potential to destruct the hybrid empire and civilization that developed over a long period of time. Its late 19th and early 20th century debate on the identity and reinvention of China. Kang Chao notes that Kang strongly opposed talk of establishing a Han-centered China, an effort he viewed as ignoring the new reality of multi-ethnic state. The Qing government should instead, he argues, foster a strong national identity by bringing together all ethnic groups within one single state to be named as Chunghua Kuo, state of China. This should be done because Han Chinese, Manchus, Mongols, Muslims, and Tibetans are all Chinese without any distinction and all belong to a single state. The strength of hybrid Chinese empire state lies in its multi-ethnicity. Building a multi-ethnic national status of China, Kang writes, should provide for a strong multi-ethnic army with enough strength to counter threats from abroad. Our China, he writes, if mobilizes troops of Miao and Kansu Hui Muslim race, fierce, valiant warriors of Chu army, along with those from Jiangsu, Zhejiang, Sichuan, Guangdong, who are rich in wisdom and intelligence skill, the trained militia could have the strength of more than 20 million. With a financial resource of at least 7 billion, we can expand within 5 years our knowledge of the world through translations of books and further studies. There is no way that China can perish. In order to build a strong nation state, it is necessary to strengthen the Qing state, whose scenic characteristics could hardly be doubted. The Chineseness of the Qing has been apparent from the beginning of their rule. China's ritual music and political system still follow Zhou Kong and Confucius. So further, the Sinicized Manchus have contributed greatly to the expansion of Chinese territory through extending the control over three northwest provinces of Mongolia, Xinjiang, and Tibet, and thus making China the world's largest country. The Chinese have now enough credentials to aspire for the world leadership. So in order to save hybridity of Chinese empire, an invigorated effort by intellectuals is necessary. the Western concept of nationalism accompanied with its specific notion of progress and modernity need to be resisted in order to save Chinese tradition and culture. The path for the modernity and progress must be found within Chinese historical experiences. Intellectuals need to rise and protect the unity of China and ward off all attempts for its fragmentation, as well as creation of Western style, the small nation state. Kang presents the case of India as of totally hopeless, more so because he dreaded consequences of an agitation or a revolution for the independence of provinces in China. Any breakup of China to demolish the Qing state would also have consequences over the imagination of multi-ethnic empire, a state of China. So whether we indulge in this with the support of one or a group of civilized a rude nation state, the result would be similar to India. To a great extent, such beliefs of Kang were privileged by the mainland New Confucian, whose basic orientation pertained to the construction of new nation state in the framework of a reconstructed Confucianism. In fact, getting confident with the rise of wealth and power and developing fear and anxieties over rising indignation among the people at the incomplete process of West-inspired modernity, the state legitimized New Confucianism as a powerful alternative source of knowledge by 1980s. Its agenda focused on the reconstruction of the national spirit, Min Su Qingshan, the establishment of moral values, the organization of an ethical order, the formation of educational principles, the forging of a common value system, the cohesion of the nation-state, and the further promotion of China's cultural and ethical progress. Rising up to occupy influential status to the official cultural and educational bodies, New Confucians promoted Hangyu Wei and his interpretation of Confucianism as a significant guiding spirit. They likened Kang's promotion of Kong Yuan Confucian tradition associated with the Han official Tong Chung Shu as reaffirmation of their larger activist vision of political Confucianism as national religion. So concluding this, what is evident are the rise of voices rejecting mimicry of the West and supporting those ideas of hybridity and pluralism, which were based on traditional morals of harmony and peace that were abandoned under the overwhelming pressures of the mainstream ideas and vision of the May 4th. These alternative voices were misunderstood in their own time. Kang had to flee from his own country and spend much of his active life in different countries abroad. Since the opening of China in the 80s and the spectacular growth of her wealth and power, these voices are, however, getting increasingly louder and employed by the state to reconfigure the May 4th nationalism. Finally, I must say that my purpose in highlighting these alternative stirrings is to indicate their continued resistance to the Western narrative of enlightenment and modernity, and to draw attention to the likelihood of their growing role in the construct of a hybrid nationalism or nationalism with Chinese characteristics. Would China as a pure civilization state remain completely different from Western nation states and open up new alternative to build world harmony? Or, as an astute commentator of China's preaching textual study group says, China's rise may have two different strategic goals, namely to establish either a humane authority or hegemony. These questions have remained unanswered. It is, however, hoped that the young and fresh Indian scholarship on China would probe further the nature and ramification of such development to comprehend ideological underpinnings of China as a modern nation state. Thank you.
Thank you, sir, for your very illuminating presentation. With that, our esteemed guests, ladies and gentlemen, respected participants, respected colleagues, and my dear students, we come to the end of this inaugural session. Our next session starts at 11:15 sharp, and it will be done in the KISCO WebEx meeting. Thank you all.